March Wellington, which reputedly marks the steadiness with which the Gloucestershire Regiment served Wellington during the Napoleonic Wars, and which tonight marks the end of the first programme in a new series of On Parade. I hope you've enjoyed seeing us back with you on Thursday evenings as much as we've been with you. That's absolute rubbish!
Hello and welcome to Volume 8 of the Pick of the Radio Bloopers.
Right, can I have your name, John?
Yes, my name is John.
It's always a good idea to get things sorted, but preferably before going out on air.
Right, Bob, we were talking earlier. Am I right in thinking that you were the Yorkshireman?
That's right.
Yeah, that's it. And let me see, Tiverton, that's right. And you married your wife?
That's right.
And from day one of any new station, everything has to be perfect, with the presenter speaking in a normal voice and at the right volume.
And between now and 11 o'clock, my first competition, well, my second one, really. Whose house? Here's some Bach.
One, two, three. Can you just read in a normal voice? Because I think we're peaking the wrong way.
Such perfectionists, these broadcasters. But then what in broadcasting terms is a normal voice?
...to fight her case after her Tory-run council took legal action against her. Hard-up Joan had tried to plead that she could not afford poll tax out of her meagre invalid benefit.
If in doubt, refer to a benefits expert.
The local authority has a duty to provide practical help in the home for deaf-blind people, and if they come up against a brick wall, they really should make use of the new complaints procedure.
As well as going to hospital. Still, you can lie there in bed all day and listen to the radio. Lovely.
Good morning, it's Morning West on BBC Radio Bristol. I'm Roger Bennett until 9 o'clock. In fact, I'm Roger Bennett after 9 o'clock. It's Tuesday the 5th of November.
Good to get that established.
Time for police traffic news, and it's Dave Sage with us this morning. Morning, Dave.
Hello, Dave.
Hello, Dave.
Hello, Jane.
It's Roger, actually. You're on the wireless.
That was Max Jaffer. No, it wasn't. It was Sam Jaffer, I beg his pardon. I was thinking of somebody else. As you know, the time is 18 minutes past 8.
Now, the latest traffic information across to Police Traffic Control, and a very good afternoon to Keith Liddermond. Keith, good afternoon.
Good afternoon, Keith. Well,
Adrian.
Adrian. Well, main problem there in...
You're Keith, I'm Adrian, OK?
OK, then.
Fine.
Yes, Adrian.
I'm Sally Updow with the update on Q103.
Thank you for talking to me.
That was Sorry, that was Wilsh... It's 5:15, the headlines again. Home Secretary Kenneth Baker...
And from High Camp to Base Camp and off to the South Pole in a new novel from Beryl Bainbridge, based on Robert Falcon Scott's tragic mission. And if that isn't gloomy enough, Wangford's here in the studio to perform the winning entry in our Country and Western Sad Song Competition. Hank, did your soul bleed?
Luckily, your intro cheered me up.
It's moments like that which make this country, well, what it is.
There's a cricket match going on, several cricket matches going on on Boxing Day, and there's cheese rolling and dwile flonking. All the things that make Britain great, or even Britain great.
Dr. Spooner's alive and well, and living in Croatia.
The United Nations peacekeeping force in Bosnia is trying to secure full control of Sarajevo airport so that emergency supplies can be flown into the besieged city. Two French planes loaded with food and medicines are waiting in the Croatian sport of Plit, the Croatian port of Split.
Which takes us to the world of politics.
Coming round to 8 minutes to 9 o'clock. If you haven't listened to a party canvasser yet, you'll probably get a visit from one before too long. All the political parties are moving into top gear as the election day approaches.
And Mark Lawson of the Independent is back from the election trail. A little hung after that. I think I better stop now while I'm behind.
Former Tory party chairman Geoffrey Archer says the row over money from tomorrow's Curd Aid concert at Wembley has now been diffused.
You're only likely to get that support if you don't continue to flaunt your homosexuality and thrust it down other people's throats.
We'll be hearing from both Kendall and Barrow, where the counts went on for the new constituencies of Westmorland and Lonsdale and Barrow and Furness. Surprises in both surprises in both seats, shall we say?
They say that broadcasters reckon they haven't arrived until they've appeared on one of these blooper tapes. It's the same for the politicians. A little corner in the blooper archive goes down a treat on the old CV. I understand this particular tape did brisk business at the last Tory party conference. I wonder why.
What's your view?
John Major has set out the position of the government very clearly indeed. He's got the overwhelming support of the Conservative Party. We are the only party that is doing that, as anybody who watched John Smith's shamefully evasive interview with Brian Walden yesterday could see for themselves.
If I may suggest you're being evasive about my question, I said, what is your view of what Mrs. Thatcher said?
And I've told you that John Smith has made the government's position absolutely clear and has the overwhelming support of the Conservative Party and indeed, I believe, the country.
As we apparently head down the road to a one-party state. Political phone-in programmes on good old steam radio are generally quite simple. That's compared to the technical complexity of a televised programme, as almost everybody knows.
Quite ridiculous to try to deal with pay wholly without any regard to the output of the firm in which you're working.
Mr. Crawford?
Can't you see Mr. Crawford?
I thought you had.
No, I can't see him. Where am I supposed to? I can only hear him.
Well, that's right. He's on the telephone.
Radio presenters have to make sure they're always on their toes, too.
Mr. Geekas, can I ask you why you voted against?
I did not vote against.
Well, listening with us to all that at Westminster is the Home Secretary, Douglas Hurd. Good evening, Mr. Hurd.
Well, it's the Foreign Secretary,
actually. I beg your... We aren't out of date. It's a brainstorm and an aberration. I know, of course, that you are Foreign Secretary. My apologies. Thanks for putting us right.
Politicians. And those ministries, too.
It's difficult to check every badge owner when parked at the roadside. So the Ministry of Defence... It's difficult to check every badge owner when parked at the roadside, so the Ministry of Defence in its... Oh, for heaven's sake! It's difficult to check every badge owner when parked at the roadside, so the Ministry of Transport, in its wisdom, has produced a consultative document called the Orange Badge Scheme.
And as sure as God made little apples, some MP somewhere will leap to the defence of anything.
Well, thank you very much. I'm obviously very honoured and privileged to be the first friend of the Cox, although I think it's a misstatement, because all over Britain there are millions of friends and admirers of the Cox, and I'm sure that in the years to come, it won't only be in this country, but also in Europe and elsewhere, that people will benefit from this juicy, succulent, crunchy apple.
Independent Radio News, it's 2:03.
This is Volume 8 of the Classic Radio Blooper Tapes with me, Jonathan Hewat. Each year, the net proceeds of the sale of the blooper tapes are donated to the British Wireless for the Blind Fund, not to be confused with that other charity, Guide Dogs for the Blind.
Up to now, like, we haven't had the funds to do anything like that, so we're hoping, like, to help the blind dogs for the guide, like, this time.
Should be useful. We could get our national benefits expert in again.
Deaf-blind people are in the unfortunate position of falling between two stools.
If you think you've heard something like that before, you have, on Volume 2, Side 1, though it's a different voice and a different radio station. But back to politics. Overseas politics.
On the line from Luxembourg, our European correspondent John Fraser. Good afternoon.
By the way, I'm in Brussels, but good afternoon to you.
It doesn't matter, it's all out there.
And some of it a bit further east than Brussels.
Poland's Consul General, Paweł Dobrowolski. I knew I'd get this wrong.
While the government spokesman said that Lech Wałęsa was having talks. While the government spokesman said that Lech Wa... Sorry.
That's okay.
While the government spokesman said that Lech Wałęsa was having talks... While the government spokesman said that Lech Wałęsa... Oh, dear.
Third time lucky?
While the government spokesman said that Lech Wałęsa was having talks with government and church representatives... The reports do indicate that Wałęsa...
Never mind.
Let's bring in our correspondent from Moscow now, Nick Worrell. Good evening, Nick.
Hello, Chris.
The situation in Georgia does seem to be getting fairly serious tonight. Do you think it is a last stand there by the president?
Yes, it is a very serious situation, especially for President Gapsahutia. He's a very unpopular man now with a very large section of the Georgian population, and one has to say he's probably brought it upon himself. And it'll be interesting to see whether he can calm them down enough to survive as a political leader of the signs of the moment. That'll be rather difficult.
Nick, sorry, I've got to cut into your conversation there, Nick, because we're getting a problem on the sound quality there from your report from Moscow. So we'll try and speak to you a little bit later, Nick, OK?
OK, fine.
And as the planet lurches from one international crisis to the next, the journalists and reporters strive valiantly to give us all the facts as they emerge.
The convoy of women and children attempting to leave the Bosnian capital, Sarajevo, are still being held by suburban irregulars at a checkpoint near the city.
Hmm. I wonder if you remember that charismatic hostage, Jackie Mann, and his equally exotic wife, Sunny. Somehow their first names seem to be the wrong way round. Or am I alone in thinking that?
The wife of freed hostage Jackie Mann is holding a press conference at Wiltshire's RAF Lynham this morning, and Chris Bartu is with them. Good morning, Chris. Are you there, Chris?
Yes, I am. Can you hear me, Graham?
Yes.
Jackie Mann is now speaking. I'll pass you over directly to her live speech.
The precedent for sex change by radio was set many years ago.
24-hour news for the Midlands.
It's 12 o'clock. Princess Anne has given birth to a baby boy. Both mother and daughter are doing well.
It's not always the broadcasters who contribute to the blooper archives. Every now and again, usually on a phone-in or a competition, a member of the great listening public brings a unique element of utter confusion to a programme.
A general knowledge question.
Right.
Say, Walter Raleigh is credited with introducing tobacco to this country. Did you know that?
Yes, I did.
Oh, he also introduced something else. What was it, Sir Walter Raleigh?
Bowls.
Thank you very much.
Well,
it's because you don't know the answer. There's no need to be obscene.
I don't know. You'll have to give me a clue.
Sir Walter Raleigh, what else did he bring? If she set a bike, Wally, I'll kill her.
I don't know, but I thought it was even with the bowls.
Right. OK, first half of the word, think of your husband's stomach. First syllable, your husband's stomach.
Big?
No. The first syllable of the word. What do you call it when you get a little round belly?
A pot.
Yes, yeah. Wonderful. So we got pot. Right, now the next one's rather difficult. It's the number after seven. Told you all. Told you that was difficult, didn't I, eh? We'll give you time to think, girl.
A pot eight.
Pot eight, yes. And at the end of your feet...
Me slippers.
When your slippers are off, what's at the end of your feet?
Me toes.
So put them all together, you get?
Pot eight toes.
Yes. So what are they?
Potty toes.
No, well, what are they that he brought back?
What are they, what?
What, I mean, the other thing that I introduced to the world. I've just given you. We've got the belly, we've got the one after seven, and we've got the at the end of your feet. Put them together and you get...
Pot eight toes.
Yes, so what are they? What did he bring back?
Pot eight toes.
But what are they?
I don't know.
You must know what they are.
I don't. Let me get my dictionary. Oh.
What did he bring back, tell me?
Pot eight toes.
Say it fast.
Pot eight toes.
Yes.
Potty toes.
Say faster.
Potty toes.
So what are they then?
I don't know.
Hey, Bill, shall we go on?
I've never heard of it.
You never heard? Say it slow.
Pot eight toes.
Yes. Yes?
Yes.
Yes. Well, what were they brought back?
I don't know.
You've just told me. Good God, woman, you've just told me.
Pot eight toes.
Just say it very slow.
Pot eight toes.
Yes.
Well, I don't know what they are.
Give her a clue, Bill.
How can I give her a clue? She's got it.
Well, what are you asking what they are for?
Because I want you to tell me what they are. Potatoes.
Well, I don't know.
Are you on your own there?
Yes, I am.
Go and ask the woman next door what potatoes are.
I don't think she'd know.
Of course she'll know. Where do you live?
Morningside View.
What number?
Number.
When somebody lives in Morningside View, go to number and tell this woman what she's talking about. I'll come back in a minute.
One of the many gems from the rich vein of live radio quizzes and competitions that clutter the airwaves on almost every station. Let's take a break and have some music.
Here for you is something by Clannad that I simply can't pronounce. It's all in Irish. I don't know. Just listen and see if you can work out what they're saying.
Sounds nice.
That's Fleetwood Mick. Fleetwood Mick. Yes, I'll name London Labourer. Fleetwood Mac and Sarah.
There you go, in at joint number 28, that is. That's the Bridge Over Troubled Water. Your next choice, much more recent than that. Released on January the 9th, 1989, and by February the 24th, it was number 2 in the bestsellers. For you, however, it is number 27, and it's Michael Ball.
Changes everything, hands and faces.
Steady on, Michael. Buck up. Hurry up. That's better.
Love changes everything.
Oh dear, we had a slight fault there. All right, here we go back with the cruise. Sorry about that. It was a deliberate little error by my behalf. I took the wrong one off. You've never done that before. Continue. I feel such a right Wally.
But between now and then, your favourite pieces of music, and some of your favourite pieces of music, featuring lack of vocal, which makes them all the more attractive, I think, really. My hands never touched the thing. Honestly, I didn't. All I did was close my microphone and things started going backwards. We'll try it again once more, and if it doesn't work this time, I'll have a serious word with it.
Yes, it's the wrong side.
We're used to playing CDs that don't have two sides, but this is a gramophone record, and it does have two sides, and this is the one we should have played in the first place. But you can edit it together at home later, okay? We'll send you some sellotape. Sunrise,
this is the last day. In a moment, Poppy Power. I tell you what, somebody's put back the scratch copy of this in our library. Hang on, I'm just going to take it off the turntable. This is just to show that it's live radio, see? We can't subject you to a cracked copy. We've got a new copy that they sent us, a nice clean shiny one without any cracked scratches. Let's put this one on and see if this sounds a little bit better. Hang on. I've got to do a few cool things, you see. All very instant, all this. Right, here we go. Try again. Whoa! Here's one for Jonathan Hewat, I think.
Now I know why DJs prefer CDs.
There'll be some changes, babe. Now it's all play.
Yeah. Great to hear two musicians enjoying themselves, isn't it? No mistaking that. Master and pupil, because when he was learning the guitar, Mark Knopfler, one of the two on that track, very much admired the guitar style of Chet Atkins. And when they eventually met and agreed to produce an album together, the result was pretty magical. He used to be Chet Atkins. He used to be an A&R man early in his musical career. And in the case of two young lads who he got quite enthusiastic about, he felt sufficiently committed to their cause to appear on a good many of their tracks as session guitarist. And they were and are the Everly Brothers. But they're not there. So where have I put them? Oh, yes, I've got them now. It was a wonderful sort of build-up, wasn't it? Slightly undermined by my inability to find the right recording. Shall I say it again? No. Unmistakable. Sing, for heaven's sake. Bye-bye, love.
cool to the bitter end. How about a completely different kind of music?
Montserrat Caballé by Carlo Bergonzi from Verdi's La Traviata. And come, let us quaff the wine. And I'd like to dedicate that to a few people who were at a party at 6 o'clock yesterday morning. The thing was, I was in the studio trying to get to grips with everything and playing the world's most beautiful music. And when I came off the programme at 9 o'clock, all the champagne had gone. But, you know, it's marvellous to be sitting here because I actually get played, or paid. I actually get paid for playing the music.
Just like they've been doing for years on the other station.
Well, I'm sorry, we can't put up with that, I'm afraid. I suspect it might be the fault of the player rather than the disc itself, so with our fingers crossed, I'm going to put that disc into another CD player and go back to the beginning of that track, and we'll hope that we can hear the rest of the Chandos anthem without any more nasty glitches and clicks.
The mysterious world of classical music.
The Royal Gramophone Society are meeting at 7:15 this evening in the Red Cross Rooms in Duke Street in Barrow, and tonight's subject is Wagner Remembered by Mr. F.E. Eaglestone.
Let's move right away from music now and turn our thoughts to something else. Good journalists love to get the news processed in the newsroom and put out on the airwaves before anyone else. So it must be a trifle disconcerting to hear a mere DJ give out a bit of news that's only just arriving in the newsroom.
Dame Curie and Australia are world champions. See you next week, folks. 2 o'clock, same time, same place.
BBC Radio 2.
It's 4 o'clock, and in the newsroom is Colin Berry.
And as you will have heard, Australia have won the Rugby World Cup. Sorry, I'm just being handed some information right at this moment. Yes, Australia have won the Rugby World Cup at Twickenham. They beat England by 12 points to 6.
And while we're on the subject of sport, it's always useful to know who's running in which lane to get the full picture.
There goes the fire, and the athletes run. Lane number 4 leading, and it's going to be lane number 3 who's taken, and lane number 7, that is Peter Petrov, is going right ahead and finishing first, followed by lane number 3 and lane number 4.
Athletes seem to get quicker and quicker every year, especially in the longer distances like the 800 metres.
There were some good British performances tonight as well. Tom McKean won the 800 metres ahead of America's Johnny Gray in a time of 45.36 seconds. Not quite that fast, 1 minute 45.36 seconds.
Golf has its moments too, with the contestants getting themselves into quite unusual predicaments.
Bernard Langer moved 5 shots clear of the West German, who shot a 70, and complained after having his ball stick up a tree.
Then there's squash.
So are you using balls that you've made here?
I made some of these anyway. I can put my name to them. But it does make a big difference, knowing what's going to happen and cutting your own balls around, so to speak.
And, of course, football.
Pompey have a tough away match against Millwall tomorrow. Can Alan Ball's team round off a great win with a week?
I suppose the major honours must go to 3rd Division Preston North End, who scored twice in the last 8 minutes of their match with Norwich to come from behind and draw 3-0.
Work that out. One of the most riveting listens is the sports interview. It's amazing how the people putting the questions are always so very well informed.
Let's look at the King George VI at Ascot. That was a magnificent race where Diamond Shore led you into the straight. Were you at any stage of that race worried? Sun Princess pumping away behind you, Diamond Shore pulling for his head in front, and you came through to challenge. Did you have any nervous moments?
I didn't ride it that day.
Now, you were coaching in Australia during the winter. Just tell us about that.
No, I wasn't coaching in Australia in the winter, actually. I was playing cricket in the winter, but you weren't to know that.
Looking back on the match against Aldershot on Boxing Day, I suppose the defence were very pleased. Held out tight in the second half.
I don't play.
They'll be coming out battling. So it's up to us to match the effort, and but stay cool.
You've actually got your family in on the game as well, have you?
Not on the game, like.
Well, we have some more sport at 20 past 8 when we'll be talking to...
I've forgotten
who we're talking to.
He's someone frightfully interesting to do with
it's
the sporting scene.
The boxer.
But away from sport and on to what's known in the trade as general magazine programmes.
Well, there'll be details of these stories and more
in the full bulletin of world news, which will be on the air in just under an hour's time at 20 hours Greenwich Mean Time. Well, now, at this moment, I should be able to say to you that we have our daily outlook. But I'm afraid for the moment, the studio's not quite ready to bring you this programme. So until then, I'm going to indulge myself by having some honky-tonk music. So here we go then.
Not to worry. Complete programmes don't just disappear, do they?
And a little bit of the honky-tonk train blues there, which you heard because I'm afraid we still aren't ready to bring you today's outlook. Not quite sure what's going on. I'm doing my best to find out. In the meantime, I'm afraid we're going to have to go on listening to some music. But when I say I'm afraid, I hope you're enjoying this particular sort of music, because now we've got some Stefan Grappelli coming up.
When a catastrophe of those dimensions hits the fan and the airwaves, the 2 to 3 minutes of a disc seem more like 2 to 3 seconds back in the studio.
Right. Again, I'm afraid, on BBC World Service from London, I can give you no more details as to why you're not hearing Outlook at this time, as you should, because we still can't trace the... actually get hold of the programme for you, because it should be coming from Cardiff. And we, A, can't get in touch with Cardiff, and B, we don't know whether the programme has been pre-recorded and we should have the whole thing on tape somewhere. And we're doing our very, very best to find out. Please bear with us, if you could, just for a few minutes more while we listen this time to some boogie-woogie from... where is it? It's the Boogie-Woogie Man, isn't it? Yes, here it comes.
Five, four, three, two, one. Before that, 9 to 5, and before that, Love Potion number 9. So well done, Mrs. D. Wilcox of Penleen Close, Mount Ambrose, Redruth, Cornwall, Triss in you. Oh, sorry, that's a postcard. TR151NU.
There's a whole heap more broadcasting classics on side two of this tape, ones that the presenters wished were buried forever. There's a deadly mix of children and animals, and a host of unintentional giggles. Don't fail to miss it, will you? Thanks very much for the various letters, and even more for the tapes of collections, old and new. Greatly appreciated. They come from here, from there, and, well, from everywhere.
Dolly Parton, here you come again. And for the next 2.5 hours, it's going to be worth it. Actually, if you can, record the programme that's coming up for the next 2.5 hours, because there's going to be some spectacular mistakes, I think, in this new place. What do you think, Jim? You going to manage it? Hello, Jim. Speak to me. Oh, that's he's the very
no,
good start.
No,
oh,
nothing.
A very good
now,
start.
Nothing to do with me,
oh,
Gov.
Yes,
I have to tell you, there's a very embarrassed-looking gentleman next door who has just put a plug in a hole.
Oh, really?
Everything was right, leaving me. That's it. That's the mistake for today.
That's
over.
It.
We got
oh,
that one
good.
Out of the way,
right.
So that's all right. I shall talk to you tomorrow.
If you survive.
If I survive.
Right.
Have
See
a nice
then.
One.
Bye-bye.
Tempting providence, I'd say. Still, it's always good to get rid of the gremlins right at the start, so the rest of the programme's plain sailing.
The Society is urging GPs to take their patients' complaints of indigestion more seriously. And on the line to me to talk to about it is Professor David Johnston, who is Professor of Surgery at Leeds General Infirmary. Hello, David.
Hello, Jimmy.
Why have GPs apparently failed to pick up this disease at its early stages, I wonder?
I think that in the past...
You've disappeared, David. Well... This is certainly an excellent studio we're in here this morning, I must say. Everything is working a treat, and David has disappeared. So I'll give him about 5 seconds to come back, and if he doesn't, we'll play a record, and then we will have a little bit more, or have a go at having a little bit more. Right, he is not back, so we hope we'll get him up again after we've heard this. Oh, why did nothing happen? I asked myself. No, that's funny. I set that up just now, and it fell down. Ah, well, never mind. I'll tell you what we'll do. Let's try this one.
I expect every one of my crowd to make fun of my proud protestations of faith in romance.
Very cool. We'll close with one of those glorious touches of irony when staff on one radio station, GWR, monitoring the output of their main BBC competitor, heard this going out over the airwaves.
On the hour, the news from BBC Wiltshire Sound. A doctor's been accused of stealing more than £1 million of cash and securities from collapsed Westbury Builders Far, as Kirsty Gardner now reports.
It's alleged the 36-year-old doctor...
Hello, Needsroom, can you record GWR, please?
...stole from the 160 members...
Paranoia rules. Bye-bye.
Well, here we go again. Further apologies, I'm afraid. And indeed now, it is a very sincere apology that I'm afraid we won't have time to bring you Outlook today at this time, because there's only about 9 minutes left in the scheduled allotted time for Outlook, and that really wouldn't be enough, even if we could get hold of the programme for you to give you a proper taste of the programme. Do very much apologise for this. If you can possibly listen at 01 hours, by then, by Jove, we will have this Outlook edition from Cardiff for you somehow. How we get it? Well, I don't know. We're going to have to do quite a bit of searching, but we certainly will. So, I'm sorry. Well, I'm not sorry, because I say I hope you're enjoying this music. We'll have to go on with some more jazz, okay? Here we go, then.
Hello, good morning.
Oh, something should have happened there, but it didn't. I hope it will very shortly.
Welcome to another cluster of clangers, those moments when the broadcasters open the mouth before engaging the brain.
The best milk of all is mother's milk, isn't it? Breast milk. Do you look after that?
Yeah, we have to test it and see if it's got any bugs or anything and bottle it up for the babies.
Well, I'll have 3 pints, thank you very much.
I don't know about him, but I prefer the stuff the milkman delivers.
This business that they're going to have on milk not being treated may therefore contain orgasms harmful to health and so
not
on.
Not orgasms.
No, dear, organisms.
So, let's go mingling with the mighty, tucked away in what are sometimes tiny but live studios.
And one very significant number in that Johnny Haynes story is, of course, Heartache Avenue by the Maisonettes. Oh, somebody's farted in here. Was that you, right? Right.
Enough to make you leave the building.
It's exactly 8:30, and if we had a newsreader here, he could read the news summary. But we don't, so he can't.
And that could result in virtually no listeners, vital to all broadcasters, even Australian schools radio.
Miss Williams here once again. Let's go through the roll, starting with Shane. No, I can't hear Shane at the moment. Goodness me, Robbie.
Help the dead, Miss Williams, rather.
Glad I can hear your voice there, Robbie. Melanie? In Elizabeth? Forbes? Goodness me, that's quite bad for grade 5. I wonder where the rest of the people are. Anybody extra listening in? Well, we'll scoot through a quick lesson and then perhaps you can go.
Something tells me they've already gone. To a different kind of school, maybe.
What's it going to mean for competition for places, though, if in, say, 3 years' time you have a brand new spanking school on this new site?
It's been said before, and it'll no doubt be said again, never, ever work on the radio with animals or children.
Children in need, wear your new castle. No, and that was just said it.
One more? Just say it once more. Children in
need.
No,
that's enough. That's enough.
What's right, try?
No, that's enough.
There's one more. Look, John wants you to do it there. It says, make your bed now.
Make your bed now.
No, not make
it. A delegation from Somerset has gone to London today to hand in a petition about world hunger at the meeting of the 7 richest nations. Caroline Lewis joins me now from our Yeovil studio. Good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon.
What kind of initiative would you like the 7 richest nations in the world to take to end this problem?
We want them to take a much more international look at how to deal with the everlasting problem of hunger in the third world. I'm sorry about the noise. It's my daughter on the floor.
That's all right. We can put up with that. At least I think we can. Oh, dear.
Yes, just banged head. Yes, we want them very much to deal with the problem of hunger in the third world.
Let me just come in there, because obviously it'll be difficult for our listeners to hear. Have you got anybody that can help you with the baby for a second, or there is not anybody else?
We'd like them to look particularly at dealing with third world debt.
Animals can cause as much, if not more, havoc on the airwaves, particularly if put next to a trailer for a forthcoming programme.
Our constituency profile on Monday night focuses on the Copeland constituency.
That's at 6:05 on Monday night.
BBC Radio Cumbria, Lamb Bank.
Good evening. A bit of a disastrous week.
Children, animals, politics. In any combination, deliciously lethal ingredients for a broadcaster.
Your questions on Conservative Party policy to Lord Young. First, David calling from Barn.
Oh, good morning, Lord Young. Could you hold on the line just while I lock my dog up?
No problem.
It's a fascinating place and it's got a lot of atmosphere. So that as soon as the children go into the house, then they, excuse me, got some Lakeland background noise here.
It's lovely. It's atmospheric, Terry.
Yes. And, sorry about this.
That's all right.
I'm being at home. Hang on. Hello.
Right, you were saying as soon as the children go into the house.
Yes, it's a house dating from the early 1600s, and was a pub before Wordsworth went into it. So that it has a lot of atmosphere in itself, and then most people feel that...
Yeah, I think we're going to have to lose the barking dog, I'm told.
Okay, I'll leave it. I'll just go and get the dog, go in the garden.
Thanks a lot.
Okay. Julia.
The last word. But it isn't just dogs that cause headaches.
We turned the lights out, and I'd been asleep about half an hour, I suppose, and I woke up with a start and felt something on my pillow, and the cockatoo had come up the stairs in the dark, and he climbed onto my bed, and he was sitting on my pillow with me. And that's quite true.
I didn't think I'd be talking on company this afternoon with a lady who not only goes to bed with her dear husband, but a cockatoo on the, on the pillow as well.
Or three. I wonder what the collective noun would be.
So many frogs in my throat, I could start a planetarium, you know, or not a planetarium. A frogularium. What are they called? What's a frog? No, there must be a word for a frog. No, a pond?
Right, there's number three left, so what number would you like?
Number three, please.
I'm very pleased you said that. Metallic zippers, which were patented by Whitcomb... I don't believe it! I don't believe it. It scared the living daylights out of me.
RSPCA officials have condemned a man who ate a bucket of live worms to raise money for charity. Llewellyn Diamond dined 50 insects from the compost heap in his garden in Swansea and followed them up with a handful of lugworms. The 52-year-old, who also claims to have consumed spiders, ate the stomach-churning meal in front of regulars at his local pub. He said it was just like dining a bowl of spaghetti. But the RSPCA... has accused him of cruelty.
Enough to make you become a vegetarian.
Join us for Afternoon Southwest, when we shall be chewing over the subject of vegetarianism.
They say meat eaters are much more aggressive.
You keep on apologising for being a vegetarian.
I'm not apologising, I'm just...
Why do you keep saying it? You have said it so many times now, I think everybody's sick and tired of hearing that you're a vegetarian. We know you're a vegetarian.
I'm sick and tired of hearing your remarks, quite honestly. Aren't there any other callers that want to speak about the subject?
Yes, there are. If you'd like one, and if you could keep your mouth shut for a minute, we might have one. Rod in Belsize Park.
I don't like your attitude, actually.
Well, I'm sorry, but that's the way it is.
Still, vegetarians do avoid the risk of getting mad cow disease, or BSE, as it's known to the experts.
And so children going back to school next month, I believe, will be able to eat beef again if they choose.
That's right.
What was the vote for BSE being put back on the menu?
It was a unanimous decision of the Education Committee this afternoon.
A somewhat drastic way of cutting classroom numbers. I wonder if the newsrooms finally got its act together. They certainly had long enough.
After the news, I've got the guest, David Michelson, who is a jazz harmonica player, and I know you're going to love listening to things he's got to say and hearing some of his first ever played music on the air. So, tracks from a new record. And also we have your sayings of yesteryear. But now we're coming up to 10 o'clock when it's time for the news, international and local news with Radio Sussex. And at the moment, we've just lost the news, so I think it's time to play another little record in for you, all right?
The best safety net in the business.
And now, with the time just after 10 o'clock, here's the news.
The 10 o'clock news. Coal miners are continuing a round-the-clock battle in shifts of 50 at a time to control the underground fire that's threatening the future of one of Scotland's most important pits. The coalface has already been destroyed at the Seafield Colliery in Fife, and now liquid concrete is being used to stop the blaze reaching the second phase.
Never mind. It happens to blokes as well.
It's 9 o'clock. The European Community says it'll recognise Yugoslavia's breakaway republics on January the 15th, providing they meet certain conditions. The decision was taken by community foreign ministers after 10 hours of talks in Brussels. Germany demanded the immediate recognition of Croatia and Slovenia, but the ministers agreed a compromise after a warning from the community's special mediator, Lord Carrington, that a premature move would provoke further violence.
Let's have the weather. That's always a good way out of a jam.
2 minutes to 6 o'clock. What have we got next for you? All right, read you a weather forecast if I could find it.
The outlook for tonight, for tomorrow, is clear intervals developing, winds moderating. Or moderating, even. Interesting spelling on this weather forecast.
14 Celsius, 57 Fahrenheit by dawn, when some patchy fog is likely for a time.
The warmest place was Poole, 12 degrees there. The coldest was Eskdale, 4 degrees. And the wettest was Shanklin in the Isle of Wight. Eskdale Muir was 4 degrees. I'm sure that you wanted me to finally make it. That's the weather for this morning at 4 minutes to 8.
Cloudy for the rest of the night with mist and fog on the hills.
It's not raining hard, but it's a heavy drizzle, a fairly wet rain.
The weather, Wales and Western England, will be mainly cloudy, but it should clear later.
With the crowds gradually dispersing back home.
Which part of England do you come from?
Wales.
Not to be confused with the newspaper.
The front page of the Daily Whale. Did I say the Daily Whale? I actually meant the Daily Mail.
What's it spouting about today, Annie?
It's spouting whales. Brighton as the Whale was at the centre of an international tug of war.
And I believe they sent her off to a funny farm after that, to adjust to life in the fast lane of broadcasting.
How did she adjust to the 20th century, Johan?
She loved it. She welcomed change, and I think, again, that's where she differed from many members of her family.
She loved the young, and she wanted them to be able to fly in aeroplanes and go in motor cars, and indeed, she herself took to bicycles and went for rides in cars, things which were unheard of in her early youth.
I beg your pardon. We seem to be having trouble with our playback machine, and until we can rejoin Vincent Kane and the book section Meet for Lunch, here's a little music.
But let's guess what it is.
John, you're going to be our last player tonight. Have a listen to this and we'll talk. We know it's Elgar, John. Okay, he wrote it, but it's Elgar's something, something, all right? Now, the sound of the instrument probably gives you a clue as to the second word, okay? Because it's obviously a little too deep to be the obvious one. So what is it?
Any more clues?
Oh, please, come on.
Okay, was it his violin concerto?
No. How could it be with the sound in that deep? That was the thing. It's Elgar's cello concerto, you see. Fundamentally wrong.
But it ain't always the listener who's fundamentally wrong.
Good luck. Okay. We're going to play the game. You know the rules.
Right.
2 points if you get it right. You lose a point if you pass or get it wrong.
Okay.
And we tot it up as we go along at the end of 30 seconds, starting now. What is calligraphy the art of?
Handwriting.
Who created the Detective Maigret?
Georges Simenon.
Who sang about a dog called Shep?
Pass.
On which transport system would you need to negotiate locks?
The canals.
H20 is the scientific symbol for what?
Oh, pass.
Sorry, H2O. What am I doing?
Water.
Now, in Volume 7, I did promise I'd include a monumental effort by a reporter trying to cover the Pretty Maid ceremony in a small market town. So, let's get cracking with some scene-setting, word pictures and in-depth interviews.
We're now waiting for the clock here actually to strike 12 o'clock, and around me at the moment I'm simply surrounded by, I should think, hundreds of people who've come along here today to the halls of the annual fair. We are now awaiting the arrival of the Pretty Maid. The church doors are still shut at the moment, and by the clock I should think we've got about, Bill Matthews has said, about a minute or so to go. Now you know who the Pretty Maid is, so...
I should do.
Is she an attractive girl?
Oh, something like myself. Very nice.
And I thought he was a fella.
I'm actually outside of the halls of the church here now. The bells are just beginning, and the Pretty Maid is just making her way now down to the fair. So we'll go along with the town crier, and we'll just go into the fair. Linda, what's it like to be pretty maiden poet today?
I was last year's.
Yes. What was it like to be the pretty maid last year?
Fantastic.
I think that's Linda over there.
Linda, you're actually this year's pretty maid. What's it like to be the pretty maid of Holsworthy?
Quite overwhelming.
Can you tell me a little bit about the actual service? Were you actually... Did you have the blessing in the church, did you?
No, it's outside.
Nothing like an in-depth interview.
We're actually now walking into the actual fairground with the pretty maid, and quite around at the moment there seems to be absolutely hundreds of people. And she's now actually making her way into the actual fairground. Mr. Trace, you're the actual mayor of Holsworthy. What do you think of this year's ceremony? Do you think there's something special about it?
No, I don't think there's anything special at all. I would have thought it was more or less the same as what normally happens.
Now, I know that you're quite a churchman here in Holsworthy.
I am, yeah.
Is there a lot of enthusiastic sort of girls waiting for this kind of thing?
I wouldn't have thought so, no. I wouldn't think any girl's got any idea, and I don't think anybody goes to church purely to become pretty maid.
Perish the thought. But, you know, dogged determination usually pays off.
Standing quite close to me now is Dr. Pearson. I believe, Dr. Pearson, something quite interesting happened to you in the last 24 hours. You've made a retirement, haven't
you? Yes, I've been retired now for about 12 days.
What's a slight discrepancy between friends?
We're actually now here in the fairground, and here's Alfred Wood, come up from Plymouth. Now, you're actually at Saltash at the moment. Have you got anything there like it?
Not quite like this, no.
Now, you were previously the Methodist minister here. Have you got anything like the pretty maid in the Methodist church?
No.
Maybe a different tack, approaching ordinary people for an off-the-cuff comment or two.
Excuse me, have you been watching the pretty maid ceremony?
No, I haven't, actually. I missed it. I didn't realise it was on.
Do you think there would be a very interesting ceremony if you'd been there?
Oh, yes.
Doesn't really leave much to talk about.
Are you going to enjoy yourself at the fair?
Well, actually, I'm going home now. I just came up here for the morning.
I see. And you've missed all that's been going on so far.
Yes, yeah, shame, really.
Never mind. Perhaps you'll come again next year.
Yeah, perhaps, yeah.
Thanks very much indeed. Excuse me, can you tell me what you think of Holsworthy Fair this year?
Oh, I haven't been in there in more than 2 minutes. I never got off that bus.
Do you always come to Holsworthy Fair?
No, not always, no.
This is one of the first times, is it?
Yes.
Good.
I'm only just coming in over just an hour, just a dentist, that's all.
Good, right, hope it's not too bad anyway, thank you. Excuse me, what do you actually think of Holsworthy Fair this year?
Very good.
Did you see the pretty maid ceremony?
No, I didn't, no.
Are you going to have a ride in the roundabout special?
No, thank you.
Why's that?
If you get the feeling that things are starting to sound a bit frantic at this stage, it's because on top of all the other problems, the batteries on the tape recorder are starting to go flat. And that affects the speed of the tape.
What do you actually think of Holsworthy Fair this year? I think you're engaged in farming as well. Are there more people here this year because we can't go about hay and this sort of thing, would you think?
No.
I'd have given up long ago.
Mr. Cowling, what do you think of Holsworthy Fair this year?
Oh, just usual.
Now, I know you come from way down in Cornwall here to Devon. Have you got anything like it in your area?
No, nothing at all.
Thanks very much indeed.
I think we need a bit of music after that. Don't you?
Hello, I'm Richard Baker. Oh, God.
It's music we want, please. Live on the radio.
Well, we'll be returning to Richard Baker in a few moments' time. Unfortunately, we've had a little technical hitch here. The tape has snapped, and we're just going to put it right. In the meantime, here's some music for you.
If you've never been in a radio studio before, let me just describe the scene that's going on. The technical operator has taken the tape that's snapped off the playback machine and onto another machine where there's what's called an editing block, and he's stuck the two ends of the tape down into a little groove so that they are precisely aligned. And then he cuts off a little bit of sticky tape, which is very precision stuff. It's not your ordinary sellotape. And he puts that on the back of the tape, having joined the two pieces up exactly. And then he takes the tape off and puts it back on the playback machine. And all the time, he's sweating and sweating and sweating.
Well, we're sorry about that little technical hitch. Now, I'm glad to say we can rejoin Richard Baker and Melodies for You.
This
This is Volume 8 of the Blooper Tapes. My very warmest thanks to all those who inadvertently find their way into what's now become the National Blooper Archive. Those moments when the normally professional broadcasters reveal that they really do have feet of clay.
Shadow Environment spokesman Brian Gould has claimed that the most favoured alternative to the poll tax inside the government, as we understand it, a property tax related to floor space, is fundamentally flawed.
But the lesser mortals of the airwaves suffer just as badly in their own small way as they do their level best to keep going.
He did the very best that he could.
Your wife is on the phone, and she said I should intrude.
Yeah, could you just tell her that I'm in the middle of a radio interview?
Okay, little.
Thanks.
Devon Cablevision has been given the franchise to serve 2,300 quite a few homes. They say they hope to be operating by early 1991.
And the final delay is a flight coming in from Malta. It's an Air Malta flight 4240. Scheduled arrival 2020, and the estimated arrival is 2220. This is Cathy Case from a noisy Bristol airport. Oh my goodness, Cathy, it sounds like you're reporting from out on the tarmac.
This morning, all 15 ferries with British crews operating from Dover are tied up at different points about the harbour. Worst hit is the Calais route. Services to Dunkirk will be Norman.
Just one delay. The 8:28 from Parkway to Cardiff will be leaving 10 minutes late. And then on the ferries, seafarers.
People are getting away to and from Belgian ports without too much delay. And there's been room to spare in some cases.
Though they're usually called cabins, I believe. I think I'll stick to pottering about on dry land in my nice new convertible.
I think anybody who drives a convertible in this climate is a dickhead anyway. Fancy owning a convertible in this country. Just trying to think whose car it was I saw parked out here the other day. Oh, yes. Just called Andrew Neil a dickhead.
12 people were taken to hospital after a collision between a double-decker bus and an articulated lorry carrying a forklift truck. Police said the truck toppled onto the bus. I'm sorry, the police said that the truck toppled onto the bus.
You know, there's thousands of people. Just be disabled does not mean somebody walking around in a wheelchair.
But what does count is buckling down and doing the very best that you can.
I think that the lady in particular is doing her best, with the help of...
The Gadarene swine charged off a cliff just round the corner from here. Jairus's daughter was healed here. And the sick woman who touched Jesus's cloak, that happened around here as well. He cured lepers and paralysed people.
Did he now?
He also worked for the improvement of poor schools and was the president of several religious... He also worked for the improvement of poor schools and was the president of several... And was a president of several religious organisations. He also worked for the improvement of poor schools... And was the president of several religious...
Quarter to eight. Now, here's a stupid question. How would you like to find a six-foot alligator at the bottom of your garden? Not a problem, of course, for most of us, but if you live in New Orleans, highly likely. After being hunted almost to extinction in the cities in the 60s, the state of Louisiana is now, to coin a phrase... Actually, having read that sentence, the state of Louisiana was not hunted to extinction. It was the alligators that were hunted to extinction.
He also worked for the improvement of poor schools and was the... I shall cry. He also worked for the improvement of poor schools and was the president of several religious...
There are other words you could use, like church.
Church? Why didn't you suggest it earlier?
Because I was rather enjoying myself.
Thank you. He also worked for the improvement of poor schools and was the president of several church organisations.
And there's a lot of them about.
The bus lane outbound, roadworks going on there, near the Christadelphian Hall. I should get that out right.
I think it's Christadelphian, not Delphinium. That's a flower.
Yes, Christadelphian Hall, that's right, Roger.
You know, the trouble with scripts, wholly or otherwise, is they may look all right, but the test really comes when they're read out.
The number of juvenile offenders in Greater Manchester given custodial sentences is twice the national average. The National Association for the Cafe and Resettlement of Offenders The care and resettlement of offenders.
Trying to get things perfect in front of a studio audience doesn't seem to help one tiny bit either.
Bubbly, vivacious, neo-fascist Alessandra Mussolini put her fingers in her mouth, let out a series of ear-piercing... of ear-piercing whistles.
Who is this?
Pete and Dud, wasn't it?
Dudley Horam.
H.M. Bateman.
That's it, yes. Who was what?
Who was a cartoonist, and he did cartoons which were all rather similar, but the man who did, or woman who did something outrageous in the situation, you know. I can't think of any, really. The man who said shit at the BBC.
Some might feel this is the most coveted award, and it's the award that I'd like you to announce, please.
Ready? On this or on that?
Wherever you like.
Okay, let's do it on this. The award for the best group or band?
And round at the stage door, the fans gather in the hope of an autograph.
Well, there's a lot of flans here.
There's a lot of flans here as well.
A lot of flans, yeah. Well, there's a lot of your fans here signing copies of the record. Mm-hmm. No, they're not signing, you're signing, yes.
Succumbing to the giggles on the radio is a unique experience. You can feel it welling up inside you as you struggle valiantly to keep control. Sometimes you win.
And finally, a 68-year-old pensioner is recovering after spending three-quarters of an hour stuck headfirst inside a jukebox. Albert Emmett was cleaning at his local cricket club in Bristol when it happened. County Sound News, it's 20 past one.
Sometimes you almost win.
I'm asking the farmer himself to make these sheep disappear from my land.
Oswald Thistle, Kettle Produce. Pendle Councillor Tony Greaves has made And now the rest of the news. Pendle Councillor Tony Greaves has made a strong protest to Burnley and Pendle... The Pendle Councillor Tony Greaves has made a strong protest to Burnley and Pendle Joint Transport Committee.
And sometimes, thankfully, you lose.
Brian Cashman.
Brian Cashman, yes.
Runs a bookshop.
Does he?
In Gwent.
In Gwent. Is this a limerick?
No.
Oh. I thought that was the first line of a limerick. Brian Cashman runs a bookshop in Gwent. Go on.
Wait a minute.
Shall I give you the last line? I could play a record if I were you.
Wait a minute, I'll finish this, it kills me. I run a bookshop which only stocks new and used.
You've had it, ducks. Play a record.
I'm going to have to play a record.
Bye-bye.
Just occasionally, sadly only very occasionally, there are times in the middle of one of those competitions when a particular answer results in a collapse. A total collapse. And remember, the programme's going out live.
A 34 for you. Which instrument does the leader of a symphony orchestra play?
A baton.
Write this down, because when I write my book, it's going to be in there. Which instrument does the leader of a symphony orchestra play a baton? Is without a doubt my favourite line of the moment. Thank you very much for that. It was wonderful. No, you see, a baton is not actually an instrument.
Bob.
It's... Sorry, get back together, Travis.
Okay.
Right, it's a violin.
Right.
A violin, not a baton. But thank you for that, I enjoyed it. Norma?
Hello.
Do you want... Just give me a number, but come and carry on.
He's going to have to get some help from his producer, Mick.
We'll try 37 again.
37 again, right. I'll be all right in a minute. Which modern country? Mick, come on, you ask the questions. Get round here. You ask the questions, I can't carry on. I can't ask any more questions. I feel sick. Mick's going to ask the question. Right, Mick, go on, ask a question.
Of course, by this stage, almost any comment is likely to trigger the giggles, but at least the producer's now in charge.
Are we on? Are you ready, Norma?
I am.
Good. Which modern country, for 37 points, was formerly the ruler of the Ottoman Empire?
Ottoman.
Yuck. Ottoman.
Yuck.
Sorry?
Yuck. No idea at all. I couldn't even hazard a guess at that one.
Did she say yak?
Yak.
That's an animal.
This is Bloopers Volume 8. And that's almost it for another year. Doesn't time fly? We'll close with something from live satellite television, just for a change. How it came about, I haven't a clue. It continued like this for a staggering 15 minutes. This is just a snatch of what was actually transmitted. Bye-bye.
Eamon Darcy came so close to tying last week. Finished third eventually in the Volvo PGA and going along very nicely indeed today. 31 out and a birdie at 10. This is tee shot to 14. Well, a lot of the players finding trouble there. A bit fortunate for Eamon. Clatters the trees and comes out just in the edge of the semi-rough. He'll be happy to see that there. Constantino Rocca from Italy. What a marvellous season he's having. Could well be the first Italian in the Ryder Cup side. And that would be really good news. 3 under par. So 1 under for today. Round of 70 yesterday. And a nice confident sweep away. 3-quarter backswing. Beautifully placed down the left-hand side of the fairway. That's ideal. Zero. And that's a magnificent drive. That's a long, long drive down the right-hand side. And that can't be any more than an 8-iron from there. About 145 to go. As I said earlier, the course in beautiful condition. You can see the rough graded there as Woosnam plays his second. And just as I thought, he's got to just have a touch of draw. Difficult to get the spin out of the rough.